Welcome to Mad Toast Live, recorded in front of a live audience. We're at the Brink Lounge, 701 East Washington Avenue, right down the hill from the Capitol Building in Madison, Wisconsin. We're your hosts. I'm Mary Gaines, and this is Chris Wagoner.
Thank you all for coming tonight. It's a Sunday, December 10th, 2013. Thanks for coming on such a wild winter. Is this winter or summer? I can't tell anymore. I don't know.
It's raining in February in Wisconsin.
So. It's weird. We're here in the beautiful Cabaret nightclub room at the Brink Lounge. Today's show is a part of our collaborative Jazz on a Sunday series presented by the Madison Music Collective, Mad Toast Live Improv Music Workshop, with the help of presenting sponsors Ward Brought Music and Janice Galleries, WRT 89.9 FM listener-sponsored community radio in Madison, Wisconsin.
That's right.
Backed by a powerhouse Wisconsin-based trio led by Mr. Dave Stoller, one of the ever-present and always innovative pillars of our Madison jazz community, with Dave Bayless on drums and Jeff Hammond on bass, one could say that our guest this afternoon is a disciple of the legendary sax titans Charlie Parker and Sonny Rollins, probably the best living keeper of the bebop's flame on alto sax, and very notably, one of the most prolific recording artists in jazz history.
He started his professional career in 1969 by joining the Buddy Rich Band. Subsequent stints with Lionel Hampton and Doc Severinsen led him to form his own quintet and tour worldwide, helping to popularize bebop and his own alto madness styles in the 1970s and 80s. He's recorded countless albums and CDs of his own music, as well as collaborations with artists such as Eddie Jefferson, Manhattan Transfer, Bobby Enrique, Freddie Hubbard, Sonny Stitt, Art Pepper, Tom Waits, Boots Randolph, and Nancy Williams Wilson, to name just a few. He played for the Queen of England, and now he's going to play for you.
Mad Toast Live, Madison Music Collective, Ward Brought Music, Janice Galleries, Improv Music Workshop, and WORT 89.9 are proud to present Jazz on a Sunday with Richie Cole, Alto Madness, and the Dave Stoller Trio.
Thank you very much. But we're gonna do a song right now, an original song, a bossa nova. You may or may not know I'm from Trenton, New Jersey, but as we all know, Trenton, New Jersey, the home of the bossa nova. What? Of course. So you know, Stan Getz back in the day made a lot of money and changed music, would bring in some of the other home of the bossa nova back from Brazil. So I wrote a Trenton style bossa nova. This is called Bossa Nova Eyes. This is the authentic bossa nova.
Thank you.
Mr. Richie Cole. Hey, thanks for being with us today. This is wonderful.
It's good to be here, my man.
So you've been here in years past, Isthmus Jazz Festival, Jazz at 5, playing for us under the stars. It's cool to see you here in kind of a more intimate jazz setting where people can actually hear you breathe.
Well, this is my element here.
Yeah.
A bar.
So I hear you started playing when you were around 10. Is that true? Playing saxophone?
I did. I started when I was 10 years old, right?
Yeah. And then you heard Charlie Parker and Sonny Rollins. What did that do to your brain?
Oh, that completely turned my brain around. Well, see, the reason I played the saxophone when I was 10 is because my father in Trenton owned two nightclubs, one jazz club called the Harlem Club, and another Las Vegas showroom called Hubby's Inn, where they had like Louis Prima and the Traineers and all the Vegas acts. And I grew up on the roof of the Harlem Club where in the afternoon I was in my stroller. I remember this, I was just a baby. I remember, I found out later, it was Earl Bosnick and Sonny Stitt blowing downstairs with an organ group. I must have been 2 years old. I'm saying, hey. Hey, Grandma, what's that stuff? I like that. I want to do that.
That's cool. Yeah. Hey, Buddy Rich. We talk about Buddy. One of the greatest drummers and band leaders of all time, for sure. Larger-than-life personality. You played with him and started your career playing with him. What was that like as a young upstart musician playing with Buddy?
With Buddy Rich?
Yeah.
It was great. I went to Berkeley for 2.5 years, and Phil Wilson, the trombone player, came to me one day, and he said, hey, but Buddy Rich needs a saxophone player, an alto player. And I said, wow. And he said, you talking to me? I said, yeah. Yeah, he wants to, you got to show up at the Rompus Room in Queens on New Year's Day with a black pants and a white shirt. I was there. I stayed 2.5 years with him, and it was a fabulous experience. You know, you hear all these Buddy Rich stories, and they're all true, but my relationship with him was very good because I did my job, minded my own business, and treated him with the respect that he deserved.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, you're quoted as saying, and I know this is true, you've written as many as 10 arrangements a day sometimes when you've been in certain situations, got about 5,000 arrangements on file. What was your experience playing with Buddy? Did that serve for, you know?
Your
musical workout.
The answer is yeah. In fact, my alto madness orchestra, it's only four horns: trumpet, trombone, alto sax, and tenor sax, and rhythm, piano, bass, and drums, sometimes a guitar also. But my concept is a little Buddy Rich band. You know? You have four, it's not a four horn combo. It's a all out swinging big band. You know, I tell all the guys, I tell the trumpet player, you're the trumpet section. You're four trumpets. Trombone player, you're the trombone section, four trombones. And the other saxophone player, you're 2.5 saxophones, and I'm 2.5 saxophones, five saxophones, right? And that's the way we put it. There are no subtleties. Like Buddy Rich used to say, you guys play loud, I'll do the shading. That's the way I approach it.
And you said, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
That's awesome.
So you were a former chairman of the board for the National Endowment of the Arts.
Yeah, believe it or not.
Say no more.
I mean, it's pretty cool that they had a musician.
I was the only musician.
Okay.
All the rest of them were educators.
So what language did you speak to them? I'm sorry.
What's the next question?
Okay, well, maybe a serious question, I don't know. As musical tastes keep shifting, economy has us perpetually perplexed. National consciousness kind of regarding support for the arts has seemed a downward spiral for a while. Do we just hunker down and muscle through this, or do you have an opinion about things we, as music teachers, music lovers, concert goers, could do to help lift the status of arts in American from your experience now?
Status of, like, what I do?
The arts in general.
Well, it's getting tougher and tougher with everybody's got the economy crunch, right? I mean, people have less money to go out and, back in the day, man, they used to give me some good money, give me a plane ticket, a place to stay, kind of like you guys are doing right now with me, first class. But then I get to some gigs, I got to buy my own ticket, I got to find stay on somebody's couch, fly to Raleigh, North Carolina for $100. Which I don't do, of course, but that's what the offers are, you know? It's ridiculous.
I keep hearing about this. Major jazz artists in New York or wherever doing that. You know, the people are our idols who are in that position still. It just seems just outrageous. Yeah.
But you know, the way I see it, if you want me to work for you, you get me there. I shouldn't have to pay my own way to come work for you for nothing. Don't get me started here. You should try to change the line of questions.
We want to get back to we want to get back to some music.
I'll get Jersey on you quick.
I did read a funny thing just this morning about Arlo Guthrie playing a benefit for left-wing people, and they said, "Well, hey, we're left-wing. You're paying a benefit for us. Can't you do it for free?" And he said, "The only gigs I do are for left-wing people."
Yeah. Well, you know what? So. When I was living in Hollywood, I lived right next to Sammy Davis Jr. in Benedict Canyon, and we used to go hang out. This is back in like 1979, 1980. And something came up while we're hanging out, and he said he's going to do a benefit. Oh, benefit, Sam, that's good, man. That's real, real polite of you. You know, he said, yeah, but of course I have my benefit fee of $50,000. He did a benefit, but they, you know, nobody works for nothing, man. I mean, you shouldn't work for anything. You know, you guys are working in mills and offices and teaching school and doing whatever you do, driving trucks, and you got benefits of some kind, probably. You make a salary. We don't make a salary. We gotta, we gotta be a composer, a musician, and a businessman.
Self-employed.
And believe me, I'm the worst businessman in the world.
So, yeah. We'll talk. I know you guys want to hear some more music. Thank you for sharing. We'll be back talking with members of the Dave Stoller Trio in the second half of the program. Mr. Dave Stoller on the keyboard, Dave Bayless on drums, Jeff Hammond on upright bass. But back to some music with Richie Cole, Alto Madness, and Dave Stoller Trio.
All right. I'd like to play an original song for you right now. This is a. This song I wrote for a dear friend of mine. Actually, in 1979, Brenda Vaccaro introduced me to this man. I mentioned his name to her, and she said, "Oh my God, you can have him." And I've had him ever since 1969. And his name was Professor Irwin Corey. Yeah. And I was stranded one afternoon in New York a few years ago. I went over to Sniffin Court, which is where he lives. And was hanging out with the professor all afternoon. It was just great. I mean, this guy, you know, it's not an act what he does. He's for real. You know, like Tom Waits, he's for real. He's not an act. Some people are just the way they are, right? I wouldn't know about that, but. Anyway, he told me all these great stories. This has words to it and everything. It's been recorded by a couple of people. But this is called An Afternoon with Irwin. My experience with him, what an afternoon. Thank you. The professor, and furthermore, hey, this is hot off the press. It's a little story behind this too. I write a song because either I think of something or I'm involved in a situation. Well, this was a situation. I have a very good friend of mine I've known for over 30 years. He lives in Las Vegas, and naturally his name is Klaus von Vegas. It's true, Klaus von Vegas. And he is the husband and manager of his wife. Her name is Diane, but she's in show business too. She's her show business name is Sunset Thomas. She's a major adult film star. And she asked me, I don't know if she asked me if I volunteered. I probably volunteered. To write a theme song for her, for her act. You go, what? I'm a professional. So I wrote it, and when you get home, look Sunset Thomas. She's a big porno, I mean, adult film star. And this is called Sunset's Theme. You can almost see her. Let's listen. Thank you.
Awesome. Woo! Hey, a couple questions for you, before, if you don't mind. Before, just real brief here. I wanted to mention to this folks here, especially about, you have a number of performance projects, Jazz Outlaws with Manhattan Transfer's Tim Hauser, Richie Cole and Five by Design, the vocal group, and the Alto Madness Junior Orchestra that goes along with your Alto Madness Orchestra. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, right. Back in 97, something. Excuse me. Sorry. I had this concept. We were talking earlier about the Alto Madness Orchestra, the little right. Buddy Rich band. So this is my hobby, really. This isn't really what I do. What I do is write music. That's why this is just my therapy here. But I have about 6,000 charts now for four horns, trumpet, trombone, alto sax, tenor sax, pianist, bass, drums, and guitar. Eight pieces, sometimes seven, without a guitar. Anyway, I have the Alto Madness Orchestra working in Los Angeles, San Antonio, Chicago, Madrid, Trenton, New Jersey, and New York, and Miami. I got different, I'm like the Lester Lannon, the hip Lester Lannon of the, Lester Lannon, for you don't know, is a society band in New York. He's got about 30 bands working. They're all the Lester Lannon band, but you'll never see Lester Lannon. He's too busy counting his money on Park Avenue. it's not my story. Anyway, I wrote, you know, these are some challenging arrangements, and I wrote some charts that were, you know, that can are playable by younger musicians. Right. So I call it the Alto Madness Junior Orchestra. And musicians from anywhere, 10 to teenagers, or sometime younger. And this is a lot of the same charts, but just simpler to play, you know, not so challenging. Since sometimes I've done a concert before, the Alto Madness Orchestra, my boys, and the Alto Madness Junior Orchestra, and the Alto Madness Senior Orchestra. That's grandma and grandpa. and they're the same charts, the junior orchestra and the senior orchestra, the same hardness, or whatever you call it, difficulty. So you got the little 8-year-old kid playing saxophone. You got the 80-year-old man, the grandfather, playing saxophone right next to him. So I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, your quote, one of your quotes is that music appreciation really needs to start with the young folks, obviously, to keep driving this thing. But isn't it great when older folks say this is something they always wanted to do?
And it is, you know, because a lot of these older people they played instruments for many, many years, and then they got involved in some kind of business or whatever to make money, and they just gave it up for years and years. So this gives them an opportunity to come back and not only play their instrument again, but to play right next to their grandkid.
that's kind of cool,
huh?
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So we've been on the phone a little bit over the last couple of weeks, and you've been in a studio in Colorado. What are you working on out there? You
got
that studio out in Colorado. You were working on a project, new project, or just you're writing, right?
Yeah. How about those Packers?
How about them Packers? All right. Shut my mouth. Yeah. Yeah. We should. I'm going to talk to the Dave Stoller Trio briefly, just to kind of introduce these guys again and get back to some music with the band.
Dave is one of the busiest keyboard players in Madison area, and he's working on his own Madison-based trio, as well as the perpetually award-winning Tony Castaneda Latin Jazz Band.
Yeah.
They're good, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, for those who want...
So
is
Dave,
this on?
Yeah. You've played with Richie before at the Isthmus Jazz Festival and
right.
Jazz at Five as well?
Yes.
Oh, cool. What was that like?
Well, you know, I mean, the Isthmus Jazz Festival is it's almost reached an iconic stature in terms of yearly events that happen here in Madison, and really shows that, you know, there are a substantial number of people who are interested in keeping jazz going locally, so that's a good thing.
Yeah, very good. Good. And you put together this wonderful symbiotic trio.
Yeah, well, these guys, this is kind of my, I guess if you were to... I mean, I have numerous rhythm sections I work with, but I've known these guys the longest. Dave Bayless, the drummer, and I have been working together on and off since the fall of '87, when we had a regular gig at the Hyatt in Milwaukee. And Jeff and I, we don't work together on a regular basis, but we've been playing together on and off since the early 80s.
Mr. Dave Bayless, faculty member of Wisconsin Conservatory of Music, worked with a who's who of jazz from Slide Hampton, Jack McDuff, Frank Morgan, James Moody, Ernie Watts, and others. Mr. Jeff Hammond also appears weekly on the National Public Radio show based right here in Madison, Mr. Michael Feldman's What Do You Know show. Probably may have seen there if you've been there. Also teaches at the Wisconsin Conservatory of Music, told being a clinician at many universities and schools throughout the Midwest. I've heard a lot of great things about the Wisconsin Conservatory of Music over the last three decades. It seems to cater to about every musical taste. So what an unusual and refreshing model for a music conservatory. What's it like for you guys?
The conservatory has a long history of jazz. It was a college, and it was one of the first schools to offer a degree in jazz studies back in the 70s.
Yeah.
And around 1982, it turned into a community music school. And since that time, we've had a lot of great players come through that. Brian Lynch, David Hazeltine, Lynn Ariel, a bunch of people. And recently, our director, Mark Davis, has been doing a great job there. And our student group, for the second year in a row, was chosen to go to the Charles Mingus competition in New York for the second time. And that's through a wonderful grant by the Baderman Foundation. And they're going in a few weeks and compete with some of the most incredible students that I've ever heard, high school age.
Yeah. It's a Madison cool. Music group. Well, thank you for all being here. In Richie's own words, there's nothing to replace music that comes from the heart and soul, so we should let the music speak for itself. Richie Cole, Alto Madness, and the Dave Stoller Trio.
It's time for the original. Where are we? Madison Blues. Okay, folks, once again, thank you so much from me and all the guys in the band, and we're going to play one more song for you, then we got to go out and shovel some snow. It's part of the contract. This is a song I wrote many years ago for one of my favorite jazz clubs, and one of the first jazz clubs I got involved with in the world, down in Washington, D.C., a friend of mine named Harold Kaufman, who is a psychiatrist, a lawyer, and a jazz piano player, and a dear friend of mine. And he did them all well. He opened a club in Washington, D.C. We called it Harold's House of Jazz. And here's the theme song for Harold's House of Jazz. I'd like to play it for you right now and bid you adieu.
Richie Cole. Richie Cole, Alto Madness, and the Dave Stoller Trio. This is Dave Stoller, Dave Bayless, the drums, Jeff Hammond on the bass, Richie Cole. Today's show is part of our collaborative Jazz on a Sunday series produced by the Madison Music Collective and Mad Toast Live. You can find out more about Madison Music Collective by visiting madisonmusiccollective.org. Find out about upcoming shows and stream or download past episodes at madtoastlive.com. Mad Toast Live can also be heard Friday nights at midnight on WORT, W-O-R-T 89.9 FM, and weekdays at noon at localsounds.fm. You can find out information about becoming a member of the Madison Music Collective by visiting their website, madisonmusiccollective.org. And you can also make a donation to Mad Toast Live to help maintain our ongoing operations by clicking on the donate button on our website, madtoastlive.com.
This program is made possible in part by a grant from the Dane Arts, dues from the Madison Music Collective members, and charitable gifts from the MMC board members and other local friends of the music. The producers are also grateful for support from presenting sponsors, Janice Galleries and Ward Brought Music, promotional support from WORT-FM and the Isthmus, and ongoing support from our program hosts, The Brink Lounge.
Special thanks to our technical producer and recording engineer, Mr. Andy LaValle, Bear Sound, front of house engineer, Adam Baranek, audio intern, Taylor Ryan, video intern, Mr. Kyle Austin, all of the Madison Music Collective board members and volunteers.
Thanks again to The Brink Lounge and WORT 89.9 FM, listener-sponsored community radio in Madison, Wisconsin. Thanks for listening.